Hey, hi everyone, good morning, welcome to our channel. So today we are going to share like UnitedHealth Group interview experience. So recently, before that, my name is I'm a full stack developer. So recently I have attended an interview with UHG or Optum, you can say. So in this overall interview process, I have been interviewed four, and like there were completely four rounds of interview. So first round was like a written exam, which consisted of an objective type, and there were two technical rounds and an HR discussion. So basically this interview was for a full stack developer. So the technologies or the technical stack that was covered in this interview was like Java, Angular, REST, Springboard, DB related and Git related. So in this slide I've tried to explain like what all happened on the day. Like basically that was a scheduled interview, but believe me, it was not less than any walk-in drive. So as soon as I have entered the interviewer like the hall where the interviews were getting conducted, a person from an HR team, I believe, walked to me and handed over a paper which consisted of all the objective types. At once, like all the objective types were looking very simple, like why they have even conducted that written exam. But believe me, there was a twist behind each and every question. So if you are attending the interview of UHG, so please be alert while answering the questions, because there was definitely a twist behind every question, each and every question. Like 30 questions were twisted. So after completing the first round, like the result was declared for the written exam, I was called for face-to-face interview. So in this video, I'm only trying to share my round one interview experience, like questions that were asked me as part of round one, because when I was including the round two questions, it was becoming a very lengthy video. So I thought of sharing it in a multiple videos. So in this video, I'm also skipping the general questions like what are your roles and responsibilities, tell me about yourself and such stuff. So the first question that was asked to me was like, explain the solid principles in detail. So I have also given a short answer here, like if you want to see it, halt for a moment and go through it. But believe me, he was expecting the answer in a detail, may, because if you are having 5+ years of experience and if you are not able to answer this question in detail, believe me, it won't have a positive impact on you. So I would request, if you are not aware of this question, please go through it in Google and be well prepared. So the next question was like, this was a basic question, like it was on StringBuffer and StringBuilder. So he was asking me like, explain in detail in which scenarios what you will use and what are the differences between StringBuilder and StringBuffer. So I also provided the answer for this also. So basically string is immutable, whereas StringBuffer and StringBuilder are not. And when coming to StringBuffer, it is a synchronized, whereas StringBuilder is not. So and the third point I would like to say, the string concat operator internally uses StringBuffer or StringBuilder. And the fourth point would be like, for string manipulations in non-multi-threaded environment, we should use StringBuilder or StringBuffer class. So the next question was like on the static. So the question was like this, like, can we access a static method of a class through null reference? If yes, how? And if no, why? So I have also given a short example of a class here. So we can access a static method using null reference, because static members belong to the class rather than instance. But we should try to avoid such coding, as it may mislead to someone who is looking at the code. So please, you can halt for a moment and go through that code which I have given, but definitely we can access it. So the next question was like, what are the difference between interface and abstract classes? So I have given in a detailed explanation of the difference between both of them. Like if you take type of methods, interface can have only abstract methods, but abstract class can have abstract and non-abstract methods. From Java 8, it can have default and static methods. Like from Java 8, interface can also have default and static methods. Coming up to final variables comparison, variables declared in Java interface are default final, but when coming to abstract class, they may contain non-final variables also. type of variables that are used. Like abstract class can have final and non-final, static, non-static variables. Interface can only have static and final variables. Implementations. Coming to the implementation, like abstract class can provide the implementation of interface. Interface can't provide the implementation of abstract class. So inheritance versus abstraction. A Java interface can be implemented using keyword implements, and the abstract class can be extended using keyword extend. So multiple implementations. An interface can be extend another Java interface only. An abstract class can extend another Java class and implement multiple interfaces. So accessibility of data members. Members of Java interface are public by default. A Java abstract class can have class members like private, protected, etc. So the next question is, what benefit do we get by allowing a default method in an interface? To be frank, I had my own explanation of this. So let us consider this scenario. Like there is a interface like A, for which there are four implementations like B, C, D, E. So now I want to add one method in interface. So if we are adding a method in interface earlier to Java, right? So now we need to change in all the implementation classes, even though if you need it or you don't need it, you need to override that method. But now from Java 8, if you want that scenario, you can directly add a method in like default or static method in interface, and the respective class can make use of it. So this is my own way of explanation. You can have your own answer. So the next question was like try on the try and resources, like what is the benefit, like what is try with resources, and what will happen if an exception is thrown in try? How will the resource get closed? So with the example I have tried to explain here, like please go through the code here. So when the try block finishes, the file input stream will be closed automatically. This is possible because file input stream implements the Java interface, java.lang.autoclosable. This is very important. You should know this. Like if at all the the class is implementing the interface java.lang.autoclosable, only then it would work. Like try with resource would work fine, or else it won't work properly. So all classes implementing this interface can be used inside try with resource constructor. So the next question is like, what is serial version UID? What would happen if you don't define this? I hope many of you would be aware of this, like what is the importance of serial version UID and what would happen if you don't give this. So I am not going in detail explanation. If you want, you can go through the answer which I have given by passing the video. So the next question is like, what will happen if one of the members in the class doesn't implement serializable interface? Yeah, this is a bit tricky question, I would say. So I would like to explain this. Like when you try to serialize an object which implements serializable interface, in case if the object includes a reference of a non-serializable object, then not serializable exception will be thrown. Many of us may not know this. Like everyone may think like it may not serialize the object, but it is not. Like it will definitely throw an exception. So please go through it if you are not aware of it. So then there was a question, like this is a simple level question only, like what is double level locking in singleton design pattern? So I have also given the code, like if you are not aware of it, like what is double level locking. So please go through it. You can halt the video for a second and you can watch it. Like then the next question was like, which class contains a clone method, clonable or an object method? So this is a bit tricky question. If you go with the name, the clone method, ideally we would think like it would be in clonable interface, but no, it is present in object. Clonable interface is a marker interface and it doesn't contain any method inside it. So please be aware of it. It's a bit tricky question. Even this question was asked me as part of the objective, like the written exam also. So then the next question was like, what is the difference between collection.synchronized map and concurrent hash map? So when you make a map thread save by using collections.synchronized hash map, it logs the whole map object. But concurrent hash map works differently. It does not log the whole map. It just logs the part of it, like segments. It is divided into segments, and the thread on which on which segment the thread is acting, that will be locked, not the entire concurrent hash map will be locked. So if you are using, if you want to use a map in a multi-threaded environment, I would always recommend you go with concurrent hash map. So the next question was like, what do weak hash map, how do weak hash map works? So weak hash map is nothing but like weak hash map works like a normal hash map only, but users reference for keys, but uses like weak references for keys, which means if the key object doesn't have any reference, then both key value mapping will become false. They will become for like whenever they don't have a reference, they will be eligible for garbage collection. So the next question was like, what is your understanding on RESTful web services? So the question is very simple, like just like SOAP. Like SOAP, I hope everyone is aware of like SOAP, Simple Object Access Protocol, which is used for develop web services by XML method only. But when comes to RESTful web services, it uses web protocols, that is HTTP protocol method. They have the features like scalability, maintainability, help multiple application communication built on various programming languages and etc. This was my own way of explanation. You can have your own way of your explanation. The next question was like, what framework you had used to develop RESTful services? So it completely depends on your personal experience, like it's completely depends on your project. So my project was using Jersey, like we have implemented the Jersey implementation. So I have given him this that answer. So whatever the other, like whatever your application would use, to please go ahead with that and expect a follow-up question like why you have chosen that method only, like why you have chosen that implementation, not the other implementation. So I would like you brush up on that also, like why you have used that certain implementation, not the other implementation, like what what advantages you were getting with that implementations. So the next question was like, what are the idempotent operations? So if you are working with REST and if you are not aware of this, I would like to say like it would definitely give a bad impression on you. So like idempotent operations are nothing but like if you go with GET, which produces the same response no matter how many times you use them. Example, sending multiple GET requests to the same URL will result the same response without any side effects. Hence, it is known as idempotent. So like you would have already worked on GET services, like there are a couple of things, like every time, no matter how many times you hit the GET service, you will always, it will always produce the same result. So that is called idempotent. Even the delete operation is the same, even the put is same. So on the other hand, like if you go with the post is not idempotent method, because if you are sending multiple post requests, it will result in multiple resource creation on the server. But again, like put is an idempotent. If you are using, it will only update the resource. So the next question was like, what is the difference between controller and REST controller? So basically the difference, like I would like to say, like with the thread response body, that is now not required with REST controller. So I have also given the answer. If you, I would go with like, there are many differences between thread controller and thread REST controller, but the most important one is that with thread REST controller, you get the thread response body annotations automatically, which means we don't need to separately annotate your handler method with thread response body annotation. This makes development of a RESTful web services easier, like we are removing that one extra line of code. So the next question, like, can we add a payload? Can you do payload in HTTP delete or get methods? So the straightforward question is no, we cannot send a payload for delete and post operations. So the next question is like, what, how much maximum payload you can do in the post method? So up to my knowledge, there is no such restriction in it. So I've also given the answer, like you can pass unlimited data as payload to the post method. Still you need to take practical things into account, like sending a post with large payload will consume more bandwidth, take more time and present performance challenge to your server. So the next question these are like generic questions, like if you are attending 10 interviews out of 10, like 6 to 7 interviews you will face these questions, like what all collections you have used. So write a code to compare two objects based on their employee ID what is this, write a sample code, how comparator works with stream, why hash map is not, why hash map doesn't fall under the same category, like list and hash map don't fall under the same category. So then the interviewer asked me to, I have any questions for him, like I said I have few questions which I have clarified with him, like basically what all technologies they are using in their projects, like what is the Angular version they are using in their project and such kind of stuff. So with this, my round one interview was completed. Then within next 10 minutes I was called for my second round of interview. So with this video, I have completed my round, the questions that were asked to me as part of my round one. So very soon I'll be sharing my round two interview questions as well. Like that's it for the round one questions. So I would like you to please share this interview videos with your friends, colleagues and family members if they are in the IT industry. I think it will definitely help one or the other persons, and we would request you to please do subscribe our channel for more videos, and thank you.